You know, and so she pops off real quick. How you asking me for a drink? Y'all don't have nothing to do with us. And so Jesus overlooks all of that. He overlooks all of that because, you know, he's knowing what's going on with this woman, and he offers her living water. And this is what Jesus said. Jesus said in verse 10, Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou would have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? And she asked the question about Jacob, their patriarch, who they honored as the patriarch, and asked, art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Again, Jesus passes over her words. Again, she pops off, you know, and so he passes over her words again for the second time, and he offers her living water again. Jesus answered and said unto her, whoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. The water that she was drawing from Jacob's well. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give, him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Because that's a chore, you know, you come into the well. This is what she's thinking. She's still thinking in a natural sense. Give me, I won't have to come to this well anymore if you're going to give me something that's going to satisfy my thirst continually. And so when she asks for the special water, he gently reminds her here of her past. You know, she's thrown off a little bit. So he reminds her of her past. And so Jesus said unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. So I want to stop right here and say this about that. And the thing about it, Pastor Bland, as you're coming in, is that what we have to remember in our dealings with ourselves, in our dealings with other people, is that everybody has a past. Everybody has a past. But we cannot be held hostage by our past. And so this encounter with Jesus was a way for her to experience freedom from what had occurred and for her to be liberated from what she was doing at that time. And so Jesus pointed out to her, because the way he did it, it allowed him to point out to her. And so he wasn't harsh. He wasn't judgmental, if you will, because that's what happens when people know your past. When people know your past, it's easy for them to judge you by your past. It's easy for them to be harsh. And we have heard it. I have heard it so many times, and I've been guilty of it myself, saying, you know, I don't know how they could have done that. You know, and all you got to do is turn around and take a look at yourself, and you will see how they could have done it, you know. And so it's really easy. We make our mouth say anything. And you know what helps with that, Pastor Bland, too, is when we're around people, we think people expect a certain response from us. And so we give in to the response, the expectation. We give in to that so that we can be accepted wherever we are instead of standing up saying what we really feel and what we really mean.
We call it people please.
People please, and that's exactly what it is. Thank you, Pastor Bland. That's exactly what it is. And so Jesus said to her like this, the woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Jesus said unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband, for thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that saidest thou truly. In a desperate attempt then, so, you know, her past is brought up to her. And she's thinking like we think when people bring up your past, that you are judgmental about it. So she makes an attempt then to avoid that issue. Because how many of you know that there are some painful, painful things in your past?
Oh, yeah.
Some painful things in your past. How many of you would agree that there's some things in your past that you really, really would like to forget? And how many of you would agree that it's some things in your past that, you know, every time you know, that it's just a thought sometimes, it's a smell sometimes, it's some music, anything can take you back there. You can have a flashback about what went on in your past.
Yeah, Lady Deborah, I think that, and I agree with you wholeheartedly, I believe it's a lack of courage. I think that a person living in fear, you know, sometimes we all want to act like we the big bad bear or something like that. But what I found out is the people that act like they the baddest is usually the one that living in fear. Because, I mean, it takes courage to face you.
Oh, my God.
It takes courage.
It does. It absolutely does. But there is no greater peace when you're able to face you and come to grips with you. There's no greater peace.
And I think that's because then you're walking in the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And the truth will make you free.
And that's a good point and great segue into this next interchange, this next exchange of conversation between Jesus and the woman. And so she tries to avoid that issue. And, you know, she brings up it's a theological question, you know. she tries to throw him all the way off. And she says in verse 19, it says, the woman saith unto him, sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. And ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said unto her, woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship ye know not what. We know what we worship. For salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. And so Jesus, in this exchange, he reveals her spiritual ignorance as she is trying to get him off subject. He lets her know, look, you really don't even know when you're talking about worship, you don't know who to worship, you don't know where to worship, and you don't know how to worship. Jesus points out to her that God is spirit. They that worship him must do so in spirit and in truth. It's something when you talk about worship. See, worship, sometimes we shy away from worship. And the reason we shy away from worship, Pastor Bland, is because worship is not about us. It's not about us. You know, we go to God. When we go to God, you know, we said we go to God in prayer and in supplication. Well, when we go to God in supplication, that's about us. We're asking him for something. It's something that we need. It's something that we want him to focus on. We want him to do for us. But when you're talking about worship, you got to get all about yourself. And you got to put all of that adoration, everything that, all of the adoration, you place that on God. God is the center, is at the center of worship.
That's whether we want to admit it or not. I mean, he is the center. He's everything. And whether or not I accept that, I don't think that's not going to change. That's who he is. I think the great battle is between man and God. Man wants to ascend to a place that he doesn't deserve, and he can't get there because we're so transcendent when he's the only one that's stable. But I just said something in man, and I don't think it's necessarily man's fault. I believe we were created as eternal beings, but because of sin caused corruption to come in. You know, the scripture says that the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly. And, you know, what made me think about it, Lady Deborah, was we were watching those singers, and we were, like, just kind of in awe when we look at them, at how they look, just how we look, you know. But how you remember them looking,
mm-hmm.
and I'll be honest with you, somewhere in inside, I thought they were going to look like that always,
mm-hmm.
as crazy as that sound. But I think that's the error that's in man, and the Spirit will bring us to truth, to the fact that it's all about God. It's not about us.
Absolutely, absolutely. Thank you, Pastor Bland. And so Jesus talks about true worship. True worship. There's going to come a time when true worshipers, you can't, you know, and a lot of people now even think that they can't worship God in, you know, they can't worship God unless they're coming into a building. A lot of people think they can't worship God unless they're listening to a certain preacher. You know, there. But, you know, God is not restricted to a building. It's not restricted to a particular person. You can worship him anywhere because he is spirit. You can worship him anywhere and at any time. You worship him because of who he is. Because of who he is. And so this was a revelation to her. He says in verse 24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him, in spirit and in truth.
Lady Deborah, I think he is restricted to the spirit, though.
All right.
Because I think that it's only what the spirit does is what is acceptable, because that's the only thing that's God. That's the only thing that's God. And when I think about the difference between water baptism and spiritual baptism, water baptism is something that we can do. I can get Robert put on some heel boots. I put on some. We go spend all the church money and buy a pool and whatever. And we take little June and we put him in water. We did that. But the Bible says by one spirit are we all baptized into the body of Christ. And if you're not in the body of Christ, if you have not the spirit of Christ, you're none of his. And so that's only what he does. And I can just see it so plain now, and why that Jesus told her that you're going to have to worship him in spirit and in truth. But I see it. Oh, my God. I see the fight for man to have some part, you know. Like they go over there to Jerusalem and they're proud because they baptized down in that water over there. And this is my last point with that, Lady Deborah. And I thank God for the Word of God because it is so confirming, you know.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of things that I knew before I got over here, but I didn't know where it was in the Bible. I didn't know. But I could tell, you know, something going on in church and you just know it ain't right. That Paul says, God forbid that I should glory in anything but the cross. And that's what, if you follow man, you'll start glorying in man.
Yeah.
But if you follow the Spirit, and the thing about it is, this, I ain't Baptist, but this is my last point too. The thing about it is, it's only the Spirit that satisfies.
Mm.
You know, you can do a whole lot of stuff. And I've been like that with eating. You know, when I really get on a binge, I guess I've been on about a 3-year binge this time. But I get on a binge and I'm just steady up. It look like I just ain't satisfied. It look like I want something else. I want something else. I'm steady tower going in the kitchen, but ain't none of it hitting the spot. And I think it's the same way as far as with my life. And I think that's the message that Jesus was trying to get a lady by the well. That nothing else gonna satisfy you but my spirit. Y'all can go to Jerusalem, you can come up here, you can go wherever you wanna go. But if I'm not directing it, if it's not me, it's not going to satisfy. That's all.
Great, great, great point. Great point. Thank you, Pastor Bland. And so the woman said to him, I know, in verse 25, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. So you know, in spite of her ignorance about the worship aspect of it, knowing when to worship, where to worship, who to worship, there was one thing that she did know. She knew that the Messiah was coming and that he would reveal the secrets of hearts. And so Jesus revealed to her that I'm the Messiah. You're actually sitting here having a conversation with him.
To me, she didn't want to be outdone. He was telling her, and look, really, he had tore down everything that she had come up with. And so she had to come up with some, well, I know.
still trying to have
some kind of input into it. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason I just think that I can't get nowhere with God until I get that up, humble myself, quit trying to make my point, quit trying to, and just yield and humble submission to him. Not because I'm trying to do him a favor, Trying to help myself.
That's a great point, Pastor Bland. You know, that helped me on a natural level right there. I appreciate that. I'm really going to try harder. I'm trying to help myself. I'm trying to help myself because it's not helping you. It's not helping you when you study trying to have a part. It's not helping you at all. It is not. And so I'm just really trying to help myself. Lord, I'm getting older, and it's just not a good look.
The time
is running out. And so Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. So, you know, at this point, you know, the disciples come back, and you know, when the disciples come back, they're looking at him like, wow, what is he doing? You're sitting here, you're talking to this woman.
Yeah.
You know, what are you doing? what are you doing? And so they thinking that, but they didn't, you know, not saying anything. And so they marvel that he talked with the woman, yet no man said, what seeketh thou, or why talketh thou with her? The woman then left, because now she is, she's been convinced by the conversation, by the exchange, by the audience that she had, by the knowledge that Jesus had, by the revelation that he gave her, that this man that I'm talking with, he is the Messiah. And so now she wants to share her faith. So now she believes, she wants to share her faith, and she goes in to the village. Now remember, she's a woman that has to encounter other men to tell them what she just encountered. And so the woman then left her water pot. It is telling how that's what she came to the well for. But, you know, once she had that encounter with Jesus, she dropped that water pot and went back into the village to share what had been shared with her. And so she went her way into the city and said to the men, come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. You see how Jesus had brought up her past. Now she's willing to talk about it. She's willing to talk about what was hurtful and painful in the past, what was hurtful and painful. Now she's willing to face it, and she's willing to tell the other men, look, He already knew everything about me, and he didn't mind sitting there telling me and talking with me about myself and about who he is. And so she said, come see a man. Y'all got to come. This is a marvel. Come see a man. He told me everything ever I did. Is not this the Christ? And so then they went out of the city and came unto him. It's good that they listened because, you know, they could have just brushed her off. They could have, but I'm just in my imagination can see the excitement that was evident in her as she went to tell them about what had happened to her. And so they urged Jesus. Now, when they went to see Jesus, then they went out of the city and came unto him. In the meanwhile, his disciples prayed, saying, Master, eat. But he said to them, I have meat to eat that ye know not of. You know, I imagine that it was baffling for the disciples because, you know, they were trying to be there for him and trying to assist him the best way that they could. And so, you know, they thought, in their minds that he was talking about literal food. And they wondered where he got it. Then he explained to them, look, I have meat I have meat to eat that thou know what of. Yes. And he says, what my meat is, in verse 34, is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. To finish his work. That says a lot right there.
Lady Deborah, I just that makes me happy because when you get to the place where God satisfies you, you're blessed.
Absolutely.
You know, on the way here to this morning, I'm happy about it. You know, it's the Bible talks about not become weary in well doing. You know, you get tricked. You're doing good. But you get tricked and you start letting the devil give you excuses. But for me to get in the car this morning with my wife and with my grandson and come to the church and had a mind to want to hear. Now you can lead a horse to water, but you know, if you come here with the wrong attitude, you don't get nothing, no way. But to come here with the right attitude and to listen, I feel like I'm in heaven. I'm on the right path because I've been on the wrong path so many times. It just happened. That's it.
Absolutely. And so when Jesus, we point out so many times, Jesus was purposeful and he knew his purpose. He knew his purpose. And many times different ones tried to throw him off of what his purpose was. Even in this exchange here, we can see how he had his mind set on what his purpose was. And we can see he says here that my meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. That makes me happy, Pastor Bland, because it's something to start something. But it's a whole nother ball game to finish. It's a whole nother ball game to finish. So if he had just come and started, but had not finished, we wouldn't be able to testify about his goodness this morning. But we thank God that he had the mindset that I'm just not going to start because he knew. He said, for this cause came I into the world. I came here for this. And then on the cross, when it was all over with, he said himself, it is finished. And so we thank God that he kept that mind. Unlike us so many times, we vacillate. We go back and forth. We change our mind. But he kept his mindset until the end. He kept his mind to finish that. And so say not ye, there are yet 4 months and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages and gathereth fruit unto life eternal, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that saying true, one soweth and another reapeth. I sent you to reap that whereon ye bestowed no labor. Other men labored, and ye are entered into their labors. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed on him for the saying of the woman which testified. Let me stop right there again and say, if she had kept that testimony to herself, and I share with people so often, no matter what your past is, no matter what you've gone through, there's something in your life that can help somebody else. And that's why it helps for you to share your testimony with other people. Right. We talk about that already now. Think about Sister Jean when you talk about that. Sister Jean would say, yeah, but you got to know who to share it with. And so the Spirit will help you with that. But you cannot hold your testimony and be blessed. God took you through that so that you could let someone else know that if he did it for me, he'll do it for you. May not do it like he did it for me, but he will bring you through. And so your testimony is a witness to other people about the goodness of God. And so many of them believed on Jesus because of the woman's testimony of the encounter that she had. He told me all that ever I did. But here again, we see where this brings home the fact that the Jews required a sign. A sign. They had to have a sign. They had to have something to show them so that they would believe. So then, because this woman said, he told me everything that I've ever done, that was a sign to them. Oh, it must be something to him. It must be something to him. And so when the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he would tarry with them. And he abode there 2 days. And so he stayed with them for a couple of days. And as he ministered to them, in verse 41, it says, and many more believed because of his own word, and said unto the woman, now we believe, not because of thy saying, but we have heard him ourselves and know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. And so let's go over to, let's take a look now. Well, here, we're going to stay right here. And so in John 4, verses 43, so now after 2 days, he departed and went into Galilee. For Jesus himself testified that what? A prophet had no honor in his own country. Why is that? Why does a prophet have no honor in his own country? Say again. Everyone knows him there. Everyone, and I would say also everyone thinks that they know him.
Well, there's a saying that familiarity breeds contempt. Mm-hmm. Familiarity breeds contempt. And what I've run up on is that unless a person is walking by faith as far as the death, burial, and resurrection, and self, you know, is self is just alive and well. And a person like that is can't stand for nobody else to shine. And really, Robert, what I found out is the biggest blessing in the world is to be around folks that's doing better than you.
You know, say that again, Pastor.
One of the biggest blessings in the world is to be able to associate with people who are doing better than you.
Oh, okay.
You know, there's stores, there's products, there's ways that we don't know about. Our parents didn't have no money. They didn't. We don't know or whatever. And until you've been exposed to something, you don't really know about it. You know, things that'll make your life easier, things that'll make your life or your children easier. That didn't make this one point right here, Lady Deborah. What I'm finding out now is it's a blessing to be able to be around folks that don't like you. Because they, you know, they can help you too. They don't like you, but they can help you. And like people who are prejudiced, you know, black people have been dogged out so much by white folks, they don't like to be around white folks or whatever. But it was a white guy. Now, I don't know the guy's name. I think I remember how he looked back then. But he was the one that told me. Now, this is just one conversation. He told me, he said, you can apply to rehab, and rehab will pay your way through school. One conversation. And he said, now, what you need to do is, when you sign up, Madeline, because I want to be a lawyer, don't just say you want to be a college degree. Say you want to be give, because what'll happen is that when you get the college degree and you come back and you try to get the law degree, they'll say, well, you all right, you don't need the law degree now. Just one conversation. He told me just how to do it. Now, I don't think he never got no degree, but he helped me. And so I'm just convinced that the spiritual way of life is so contrary to how, you know.
Absolutely.
So contrary. And this last thing that I'm learning now recently, you know, is folks, the haters, they don't like you. They hate to see you coming up, but they still helping you. It's amazing.
It is. When you really think about it, it is amazing. And so now Jesus, in verse 45, then when he was coming to Galilee, the Galileans received him, having seen all the things that he did at Jerusalem at the feast. You remember what he did at the feast? He turns the water into wine. Well, they also went unto the feast. So Jesus came again into Cana of Galilee, where he made the water wine. And there was a certain nobleman, don't know if this man was a Jew or a Gentile, this man had a need. He had a desire. And so there was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. And I said, we'll move brick upon brick upon brick for our children.
Yes,
look, I'll do it for my grandchildren. That one that's over there, my first one, my goodness, I love him. I said, if I got a call right now from Vandal Jr. or Jeremy, I leave this desk right here and head on out the door. Y'all have to tell me about church service later. Because we love our children, don't we? And so this man heard that Jesus was in the vicinity, and he had the belief and faith that Jesus was able to do what he needed to do for his child to be healed. And so in verse 47, when he heard that Jesus was come out of Judea into Galilee, he went unto him and besought him that he would come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. And I don't believe he would just go to anybody. I believe that he went to Jesus because he thought Jesus could do something about it. Didn't want to waste time with someone that couldn't do anything about it. Then said Jesus unto him, except ye see signs and wonders, ye will not believe. And we talked about this earlier, how that, you know, the Jews had to see something in order for them to believe. But the nobleman said unto him, sir, come down ere my child die. Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy son liveth. And the man believed the word that Jesus had spoken unto him, and he went his way. And as he was now going down, his servants met him and told him, saying, thy son liveth. Then inquired he of them the hour when he began to amend. And they said unto him, yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him. So the father knew that it was at the same hour in the which Jesus said unto him, thy son liveth, and himself believed, and his whole house. And so the man returned home to find out that this was true. Go with me now over to Luke, the fourth chapter. So we go from Canaan. He goes from Canaan to Nazareth. So from Luke, the fourth chapter, let's look at the 16th verse. Are you there? And so he came to Nazareth, in Luke 4 and 16, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day and stood up for to read. And there was delivered unto him the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written. And this is from Isaiah, the 61st chapter, verses 1 through 2, where it says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And so these verses highlight that this person that was being spoken about by the prophet Isaiah, the Spirit would anoint that person to do these things, to preach the gospel to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, to restore sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who have been bruised, and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Now, the rabbis, the teachers, the Jewish rabbis, the teachers, they interpreted that portion of scripture to be about the Messiah. And the people that were there in the synagogue, they knew that. And so here, Jesus closed the book and he gave it again to the minister and sat down. I'm in verse 20. And the eyes of all them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears." Now, can you imagine how they accepted that or didn't accept that or how they took that? And so I'm the one just shocked, in shock. They said because Jesus was bold in his declaration. He was bold in his declaration. And all, I'm in verse 22, "And all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. And they said, is not this Joseph's son?" That we're telling you, we're talking about a prophet being without honor in his own town. What in the world? This Joseph's son? Oh, my God. And he said unto them, "You will surely say unto me this proverb, physician, heal thyself. Whatsoever we have heard done in Capernaum, do also here in thy country." And he said, "Verily, I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country." You can't tell nothing about me, about where I came from. And that's what we have to instill, and we have to tell ourselves. Well, people will try to put you in a box. People will try to stereotype you. And people will try to limit you based upon where you came from. And people will try to do your children the same way. Won't give them a chance because of what they think, because of what they assume based upon where they came from. That's why we have to fight for our children. And that's why we have to fight for ourselves. Because people will just assume they know automatically your abilities. Well, Jesus looking after you. The Messiah is here. I'm the Messiah. I'm the one that's ushering in the acceptable year of the Lord. You can receive it or not. And we know that they didn't receive it. We know that they didn't. And so they are filled with wrath. And at this point, you know, they become so hateful that they attempt to murder him. But in Luke 4 and 30, look at Luke 4 and 30. Well, let me read verse 28. And all they in the synagogue, And all they in the synagogue, when they heard these things, were filled with wrath. Filled with wrath, first of all, because it's like you say, who are you? Who are you? And then how dare you? How dare you? And they rose up and thrust him out of the city, led him into the brow of the hill whereon their city was built, that they might cast him down headlong. But he, passing through the midst of them, went his way. They were not able to do that because of who, again, now his deity steps in, and he's able to pass through them without them even touching him. And so one of the reasons that they had their hatred, they were so filled with hate, was because of when Jesus spoke to them, he brought up Gentiles who had more faith than they did. And you know, they hated them. Gentiles, they to them, they were looked upon as dogs and hogs. And so Jesus would let them know, though, that they have more faith, a different kind of faith than you do because of their belief.
Lady Deborah, you know, I think that a person can't get any help from God until they realize that they not no better than nobody else. A friend of mine going to treatment, and funny thing about it is, even though you a dope addict too, you try to compare yourself to the other dope addicts. And she said that it came to her, you know, ain't no difference between us. I'm a dope addict with a couch, and she a dope addict ain't got no couch. But we still dope addicts. And I say again, is I didn't really get no help. And my thing about coming here on Sunday mornings or whenever we come is, you know, I'm looking to be reminded of the truth, because the truth is something that'll slip away from me.
Yes.
I once had it in my mind, but I got a tendency to want to believe my own press, and that'll mess me up. And so just to be reminded this morning that there's no difference. There's no difference between, you know, today you, tomorrow me.
You said to stay in the truth. That's something. It's easy to slip away from you. Again, I say that's too why it's sometimes you need somebody around you that has the courage to say to you what you can't see.
I think I was Junior. I was talking to the other morning. I said, I never wanted no dumb woman. I never wanted no woman that just whatever, you know, they couldn't help me. You see what I'm saying? That didn't have the intellect, didn't have the wasn't on my level to be able to assist me. But if you are insecure, and I think that a lot of black, I know for a fact, when I used to work at the law school, mostly black women, and all of them would say they couldn't hardly find no man. They wanted a black man. They couldn't hardly find no man because the men would be intimidated because they were educated, you know. Or if she found somebody that's on their level, they wanted 4 or 5. They didn't want just them. And so it's just the insecurity when you're dealing with, and that's probably even in marriage, and that's the reason I'm here too. Because you can't deal with an issue until you know it, and we always want to feel like it's the other person that got the issue.
Yeah, that's so true.
But you got some issues too.
Yeah.
And you could be up in the house with somebody, and the reason y'all can't go forward and nothing like that, because you jealous of them.
Yeah.
And you don't have to be jealous of anybody.
True.
Whatever is for you is for you. And like I said, one of the biggest benefits that I think a person can have is to be able to stand for somebody else to have more than you got. Mm. Don't let that bother you. Don't let that bother you.
Right.
Every one of my brothers and sisters got nicer houses or whatever, but I like my house. I like my house, and so that's why I'm here.
Amen. Well, Pastor Blaine, I appreciate that. Words to ponder and live by. And with that, give the Lord a hand. Praise everybody.